Good morning.
Good morning.
The average person tells roughly between 10 to 20 lies a day. That's in the vicinity of 4,000 to 7,000 lies a year. On average, by the time a person reaches the age of 60, they will have told over a quarter of a million lies. And by far, the most common lie told is some variation of, "I'm fine."
Today is one of those Sundays when our minister, Martin Wolf, is not in the pulpit. Our guest presenter is Tracy Zieber-Minks, a member of our congregation who is currently serving as the interim coordinator of religious education. Tracy has been pagan for 18 years and a Unitarian Universalist for 8 of those years. She has a background in the social sciences with degrees in psychology and sociology and has worked as president of the Decatur, Illinois chapter of the Depression and Bipolar Support Alliance for 4 years. She has helped establish and register the current DBSA group here in Springfield, and she is a trained crisis facilitator. In addition to her position here at ALUUC, she is currently head of the Pagan Group and co-chair of the Welcoming Congregation Committee and chair of the UU Women's Connection. Let us now reflect on those for whom mental illness is a daily concern.
Good morning.
Good morning.
It is a good morning for all of us sitting here, because we are sitting here. It means we were all able to pull ourselves up out of bed this morning. We all had the motivation to rise, turn off the alarm clock, to presumably shower and eat breakfast, to converse with family and other loved ones. We were all able to bring ourselves here and arrange ourselves in a gathered assembly to listen to what I hope will be an informative talk. All of these actions, these thoughts, the vast majority of them come as simply second nature to most people. Usually you don't have to think about getting in the shower or the bathtub every day. It's not a concentrated effort to remember to look people in the eye when they are speaking to you. When you rose to greet your neighbors, to shake their hands or give hugs, chances are your breath did not catch in your throat because of their nearness. Your memory probably didn't flood with instant signals of danger while your skin crawled at the very idea of being touched. But perhaps someone in here did feel that way, panicked, unsure, uncomfortable, even frightened. Perhaps it was even you. How do you know the face of mental illness when you are staring right into it? Would you know it on your neighbor? In your family? Would you be able to recognize it even on yourself? Most people don't. Mental illness, or as the latest version of the Diagnostic and Statistical Manual calls it, mental disorder, is defined as a syndrome characterized by clinically significant disturbance in an individual's cognition, emotion regulation, or behavior that reflects a dysfunction in the psychological, biological, or developmental processes underlying mental functioning, usually associated with significant distress in social, occupational, or other important activities. Certainly, modern media gives us a picture of what mental illness or mental disorder is supposed to look like. We've heard of books like Prozac Nation and The Bell Jar. First-hand accounts written by those who suffer the illness themselves can be an enlightening source of information. Carrie Fisher, Jane Pauley, and the late Patty Duke, and several other well-known celebrities have written autobiographies detailing their own struggles. And I'd wager most of you have at least heard of, if not seen, such movies as A Beautiful Mind, Girl Interrupted, and Benny and June. Hollywood movies and TV adaptations are unfortunately very hit or miss, depending upon how much research and care went into the project. More often than not, Hollywood depicts mental illness only as erratic sadness, violence, genius, or creativity. Rarely do the movies show the subtle nuances of trying to navigate everyday life while dealing with such disorders. It seems as if an accurate and sensitive story about the average person with mental illness would be at odds with the studio's desire for profit. Second and third hand news media accounts, however, are usually far off the mark. We live in a culture now that prizes the soundbite. Headlines are clickbait. 120 Twitter characters doesn't leave much room for true, unbiased, investigative journalism. If the newspaper reports that a man was acting erratically in public, the article may mention, tacked on right at the bottom, that the man was schizophrenic. What the paper will not tell you is that the man may have also lost his job, and therefore the health insurance that paid for his medical prescriptions, his counseling, and, well, now he's just out of luck. Our popular casual vernacular even indicates such phrases as off your meds to show when someone is acting in ways that we consider to be socially unacceptable, even slightly. Without thought, we toss around Facebook memes and jokes about how quickly the weather changes and therefore Mother Nature must be bipolar. So we think we have an idea of what mental illness should look like. It looks like crazy. And crazy is a vile joke, except it's not, especially not if you are the one who suffers from it. And it's not crazy, anyway. Mental illness is often thought of as the curse of extremes, as operating outside the established set of acceptable parameters, either for the individual themselves or for society at large. It's easy to notice external extremes. We notice and comment on extreme behavior in a friend, family member, or even a stranger. If it's unusual for person A to miss several consecutive days of work without calling to explain why, you could easily conclude that something is wrong. Well, you could go to person A's house and discover them cocooned in bed, having not eaten or showered for 2 days, and rightfully assume by their extreme behavior that they are depressed. That is the face of mental illness, and you know it, because you would be looking right at it. Or rather, you would be observing the extreme external behavior displayed by the individual outside of society's accepted, constructed parameters. Would you still recognize it if person A had managed somehow, some way, to pull themselves up out of bed, into the shower long enough for a perfunctory scrub, and into work? Would you still recognize that as mental illness? After all, that behavior is within society's constructed parameters. If person A stood before you, taking your order, changing your tires, watching your children, cleaning your house, managing a business, teaching a college class, going through all of those motions that we as a society deem to be of use and correct, would you still recognize that person as being mentally ill? That is a more difficult scenario to imagine. You don't know person A, and chances are you'll never see them again. It's just someone you ran into while out and about on your own business. Imagine instead then your wife's face, or your husband's, maybe your child's face. Surely you'd recognize the face of someone you love so dearly. You know what they look like when they're smiling, laughing, crying. Of course you would recognize your loved one's face. You know your family and friends, and you know what mental illness looks like. You would know if it affected someone so close to you. You'd be able to look in a mirror and know if it affected you. The biggest problem with mental illness as the curse of extremes is that most of the extremes are actually internal, where no one sees them. So while millions of people may wear the face of mental illness, most of them are convinced they are, in fact, the only one, alone. Mental illness is, in many respects, like so many other types of illnesses. There are varying degrees of sick and afflicted, and each person reacts just a little differently, even to the same label of illness. Again, it is all about parameters. Most people have heard of the nature versus nurture debate. Are we a product of our genes or our environment? Really, the answer is both. Our genes, our nature, set the potential for illness or disorder for all of us. It's well known that if there is a hereditary history of mental illness in a person's family, it does increase the person's chances of developing illness themselves. But nurture, our environment, helps to dictate how far each of us move within the parameters nature has set down for us. Our childhood, level of education, socioeconomic class, support system, and any potential abuse or traumas we may have faced all play a key role in determining not only if we develop mental illness, but potentially the severity of illness and response to treatment. Mental illness, like other types of illnesses, can be managed with certain kinds of treatment plans, but unlike with many other illnesses, perhaps even most other illnesses, mental illness has some unique stumbling blocks that can often prevent successful treatment. The first line of defense is always for the individual to clearly know themselves and to do their best to surround themselves with people who are loving and trustworthy. People who will care for them should they be unable to care for themselves. But the very nature of mental illness means that an individual may not be capable of clearly understanding themselves or communicating their own needs. Someone who has dissociative identity disorder may be carrying alternative identities within their own psyche, and that alternative identity may express different needs and wants from the person their family and friends usually know. This kind of disharmony can happen with many kinds of disorders and illnesses, and it's extremely difficult on the patient's loved ones, many of whom may choose to no longer deal with that difficulty. So those who suffer with various types of mental illness, sadly, often suffer the expanded loss of loved ones and even their sense of self. Different types of therapies, counseling, intervention, and social services can be invaluable for the treatment of mental illness, but not everyone has access to such services. Because of the Affordable Care Act, nearly all insurance plans are now required to pay for at least some forms of mental health services, but even if they are not comprehensive. However, due to massive budget cuts at both the state and federal levels, the facilities that accept plans, such as the extended Medicaid, are in some cases having to turn people away, or they have waiting lists that are over a year long. Some facilities are withdrawing certain services or even closing their doors altogether because of lack of funding. This ties in with medications. Psychiatric medications are usually thought of as the number one form of treatment for mental illness, and maintaining a medication schedule is important. But psychiatric medications are also ridiculously expensive and sometimes tricky. Name brand drugs are routinely hundreds of dollars for even a single month's supply. And while there are good generics out there, not everyone can take them because sometimes the secondary ingredient will not be the same, thereby changing the effectiveness of the medication for an individual. Or some people have to be careful about mixing certain medications or being watchful of allergies. And to be frank, for some people, certain medications just do not work or a person may choose not to participate in a medication regimen. Everyone's individual systems react differently. And then there is stigma, one of the main bars to successfully treating mental illness, perhaps even the main reason why politicians think it's okay to severely cut funding to treatment and research, why so many people feel it's okay to walk away and ignore the problem, or to simply become angry and wish for it all to go away on its own. It's because so much of our culture still says it's okay to blame the mentally ill for their own problem. We do not look at someone who has spina bifida, epilepsy, or Alzheimer's, all other types of brain disorders, and blame them for their own illness. Yet it's not only passé, but downright expected for someone to be mocked for being crazy, for being mentally ill. This is also a huge reason why many people either don't recognize or don't report their own mental illnesses or issues. Women are told they're too emotional, while men are often told they're not allowed to be emotional at all, regardless of what anyone is actually feeling or not feeling. Many people don't want the perceived shame upon themselves or their families if they have to admit to having a mental illness or distress. They don't seek treatment for it. Mental illness is associated with weakness, frailty, and failure. In the especially religious and socially conservative areas of this country, shame can be used heavily to persuade people not to admit to having mental illnesses or issues that need to be addressed for treatment. People are told to button up, to keep it in the family. There have been numerous reported cases of mentally ill people who have been locked away in back rooms, starved, beaten, even put through various forms of exorcism rather than taken to a doctor and being allowed to freely admit they just needed psychiatric care and counseling. For people who are already in a fragile state, that kind of abuse and neglect will only heavily exacerbate the problem and leave them with deep scars. It can almost seem then that having a mental illness or disorder could become a catch-all, that gray, nebulous area where a person could be both the blamed and the blameless. After all, we've heard of things like the insanity plea, crimes of passion, those times when a person just seems to lose their senses altogether and would, by definition, be suffering from mental illness. Someone who is unable to care for themselves and therefore certainly would not be able to care for others. But make no mistake, having a mental illness does not absolve a person from responsibility, at least to the best of their ability, or worded another way, to the end of their allotted parameters. For as much as a person is able, they are still responsible for maintaining their own care, including doctor's visits, counseling sessions, and medication schedule. Having a mental illness does not remove a person from their own humanity. And humans are, at least mostly, responsible for their own actions and choices. They must face any consequences of their choices, including loss of employment, relationships, or support. The good thing about being human, though, is that we can also choose to see deeper. We can protest prevailing media stereotypes by refusing to watch certain movies or TV shows, or even by quietly refusing not to share a poorly worded social media meme. We can lobby our politicians and governments for, for better spending policies regarding mental health funding, for research, better treatment facilities. We can advocate to end stigma. We can hold talks in public venues, teach classes, go into the school systems. We can make knowledge more readily available to individuals and families who may be suffering and needing resources. And as supporters, we can care for those who suffer, particularly and most importantly, when they are unable to care for themselves. The most important thing we can do, though, is simply to see. We must see first. Without seeing, none of those other steps will be taken. Mental illness is thought of as an illness of extremes, but those extremes are mostly internal. Only when a person's behavior becomes externalized do other people notice, and even then, oftentimes, nothing is done to help. So in many cases, Mental illness is an invisible illness, even to those who may have it themselves. So what do you see? You could probably judge the broadly accepted cultural and social parameters for behavior, sure. You know that face. You could see it in your family, friends, neighbors, even in strangers. And if you know yourself well, you'd be able to tell if something is off about your own patterns of behavior. But could you detect someone's personal parameters? The internal face, the one we identified as invisible. Still able to get up out of bed, carry on a conversation, go to work. Could you as readily identify that face? Would it surprise you to know you've been looking at it all this time? The framework for my parameters was laid by both my nature, my genes, and my nurture, my environment. And within those parameters are depression and post-traumatic stress disorder. That is the face I wear, though not many people have known it until now. My extremes are mostly internal, and people don't see them because I still get up. I face my day. I take care of the things I need to take care of. I am able to present that face to the world, but it does not make it less painful or difficult. Everyone's face, their specific parameters, their nature, nurture, illness, diagnosis, abilities, treatment, and ultimately success is individualized. No one gets there alone, even though mental illness so often makes a person feel isolated. Maybe the key to all of it is in remembering our own humanity. It could be any one of us at any given time. Mental illness and suffering is indiscriminate. PTSD can happen to literally anyone in the world given the right circumstances. Someone who is carrying the genes for depression could pass them on to their children and never be aware. You could be the child who is carrying the genes for depression and not know it till you're in your mid-50s. If it were happening to you, how would you want to be treated? How would you want to be seen? The same as any other human, with the full scope of your inherent worth and dignity, with compassion and respect. Blessed be. Assume you aren't sick unless they see the sickness on your skin, like scars forming a map of all the ways you're hurting. My heart is a prison of, have you tried? Have you tried exercising? Have you tried eating better? Have you tried not being sad, not being sick? Have you tried being more like me? Have you tried shutting up? Yes, I have tried. Yes, I am still trying, and yes, I am still sick. Sometimes monsters are invisible, and sometimes demons attack you from the inside. Just because you cannot see the claws and the teeth does not mean they aren't ripping through me. Pain does not need to be seen to be felt. Telling me there is no problem won't solve the problem. This is not how miracles are born. This is not how sickness works. M. Roy, The First Step. I would ask you to please remain seated for our closing song.
In restless dreams I walked up.